Welcome, my dear friend, to our family talk show. As always, we have been away for quite some time because of many things, but I'm so glad that we are now back. Our family talk show this day is going to talk about a very familiar subject, something that has been trending over the past few days and weeks. LGBTQIA. Yes, LGBTQIA. Well, what is this animal? Or what is this? This thing about LGBTQIA. What is it all about? You know, this is a subject that has been talked about by the great and the small. This is a subject that has been discussed by churches, by social clubs, by even political players. This is an issue that appears to be very weighty in our society today. And therefore, as members of the clergy, as the church, we also have been called to say something about what is happening in our society today. LGBTQIA, what is this? Why are we called to comment? Why are we called to discuss this subject? My dear friend, I think it is high time as a church, and I want to say this from the perspective of church and as a religious leader, that we have a reason to speak unto this subject. We must be able to give our ideas. We have to give our thinking. We have to allow what we know about LGBTQIA to come out, so that the faithfuls, so that the members of society may know how to approach this subject, or how to treat those who have come out and have identified with this LGBTQIA. Now, before we can discuss about it, before we can even look out in the scriptures and find out what the Bible says about this subject, what is this? Or is this thing real? Can we find it in real life? Is this something that is probably happening among a few somewhere very far away from our own country? Is it something that probably happens in Europe or in the Western world, if you like? Or is it something that we also, in our society, in our country here, even here in Kenya, can be able to point out and say, this thing is here, this thing is happening? Has it happened to you? Have you seen it? Have you heard it? Have you experienced it from your area, from where you come from? I do. I want to confess here before you that while I was in secondary school, I came across this this issue. I remember in that school, while I was in class, I received a letter one afternoon. One afternoon, I received a letter after lunch from one of my classmates. And, you know, in that letter, he was just trying to express himself and what he thinks about me. He said, you know, I think he didn't say I'm handsome. In fact, he said I'm beautiful. And then, you know, he would like to have a relationship with me. We wanted me to be his boyfriend, you know, like a girlfriend, you know. And I was like, what, you know? Having come from the farm, from shags, I had not experienced this. I had not seen this. I had not even imagined that this thing happens. But then I got it. I was confronted with this thing in high school. And, I was very disturbed. I did not know what to say. I did not know how to reply that letter. But, of course, with the time in that school, It became very prevalent, and I can attest this, and my friends who went to the same school with me can attest that this thing was happening there. There were a lot of boys who were having relationships with fellow boys. Yeah, I can tell you, there were many, and we knew them. We knew them. We knew their names. We knew that so and so is a girlfriend of so and so. You know, a boy was a girlfriend to another boy. We saw that, and it was prevalent. It was on a very high level, high magnitude. A great number of boys practiced gayism in school. And not only that, I think even when we got out to the girls' schools, we also had that same story. We also had that same story because we could hear that, you know, in a certain school, there was this girl who was trying to make love or have a sexual relationship with another girl, and probably she was using a banana, you know, stuff like that, and probably the banana got stuck, you know, in the other girl's vagina, you know, those things. We used to hear them, and it used to look queer, yes, but they happened, and the stories will go viral everywhere. You will hear about them. So is this thing happening even in our age and time? I think if my time, which should be right now, like 20 years ago or more, that used to happen, I don't know how much more it's happening now, when it has even come up, when this issue has even come up now in the national media, you know, in the national platform. Recently, you can attest that some organization went to the Supreme Court, and they were able to come up with a ruling by the Supreme Court of Kenya, asking them, with these guys, like they wanted to have them some kind of freedom to associate people who support LGBTQI. You know, they were given some leeway, and they did. It sparked a storm. It sparked a storm in our country. You saw what happened. You know, it went on to Parliament. You know. And the leaders were coming out saying, no, this ought not to be. They said, you know, you are ruining our society, our boys and girls. How are they going to survive under this rule? You know, it's like they were saying, you know, the Supreme Court is like trying to support an illegality or something that shouldn't be. Everybody was trying to refer to in regard to our religion. And they also referred in regard to our African values, our traditions. They all do not support this matter or this issue of LGBTQI. That's what was said, and that's what probably you are saying, or you're hearing it being said out there. You're reading it in the mass media and everywhere. But the question that I want us to confront ourselves with is this thing real? Or do we bury our heads in the sand and say that it's not happening? The truth is, and as I have already attested, this thing is happening. It is there. We do have people who practice homosexuality. We have people who practice lesbianism. We have people who practice what we called bisexual. They say they are bisexual. In other words, they are attracted to both sexes, to both males, to both females, both same sex, and also attracted to the opposite sex. That's why they call them B, stands for that, bisexual. And there are those who say they are queer, you know. It's like, you know, they are, I don't know how to describe that. Probably I'll get somebody to try to tell us what that means. But there's also what they say they call transgender. In other words, the people who feel like, you know, they are trapped in somebody's body, you know. They say, you know, I am a man, but somehow I feel like I should have been a girl, you know. Is that real? Can medical science tell us whether that is possible? Or that's what we need to know. We need to know if indeed that is possible. But of course, we have also been to countries, and even in our own country, you have had people who have had an issue where they have both sexes, you know. They have a penis and a vagina, you know. There are those people who are born like that. How about those ones? So where do we classify them? And those who are called intersex. Intersex are people who like don't feel like they are attracted to any, they are neither attracted to a man or a woman, and you know they don't have feelings, you know. Those are the kind of people whom we meet usually in the streets or in our homes and our families, and we keep on asking them, why don't you get married? You know, if you keep on asking somebody, why don't you get married all the time? You know, somebody's 30, is 35 years, you know, keep on, and he has never brought a girl home. Those are the people who are classified under that area of intersex. So, my dear friends, you know, as we contemplate this subject, can we bury our heads in the sand and say that, you know, this thing does not exist, this thing is just out there? We may not be able to say that. We must become real. I am saying we must become real and address this issue square, you know. We must be able to say it as it is. We must be able to hit or hit the nail on its head where it has to be hit. You know, we have to say the truth about this. We have to be able to bring out the elephant, yeah, bring it out and be able to face it if we are going to solve this issue of LGBTQ. My brother or my sister out there who's listening to me, I think this is a subject, what you're talking about, and I'm trying to talk about it from a perspective of a religious leader, from a person who's out there, who must reach out to the rest of the people that are living in our society. You know, how do we reach out to such kind of people? How do we do ministry to these kind of people if we come to an understanding and agree, like we are together, that these people exist? In fact, some of you parents are going to be surprised to realize that your own sons, your own daughters are in this thing. They are identifying themselves as one of these, L or G or B or Q or I. One of these days you are going to see your daughter, your son, your uncle or whoever that is going to come home and tell you this is what they are. How are you and me going to treat these people? How are we going to minister to those people? That is the big question. That is the big thing that I need you and me to discuss about. In a little while, in a short time, I want us to come out and face what it is, so that we are able to reach out and be able to talk about it without fear of favor, without fear of contradiction. Can we say it as it is? Is my wish and desire this morning as we come up to the next episode. We want to talk about it. We want to be sure that everyone has come on board and we hear, what is it? How can we handle? How can we treat those people who identify themselves as LGBTQI? Till next time, see you in our next episode.